cash inputs, if any, from the graphing function.
Okay. So we're gonna find the vertical asymptotes, if any, for this function. Why would we have a vertical asymptote? So something, everything's good and everyone's happy?
It's a long
function there? Okay, so in this case, the denominator is zero. If we had some other function, maybe we'd have an issue because we're trying to take the square root of a negative number or something, or you know, some other weird thing could be happening. Right? But typically, it's because the denominator of a rational expression is getting closer to zero. And once it gets to zero, then nothing comes out of the function. But on either side of the function, it's going crazy. So we talked about why we get a whole or a vertical asymptote, right? We discussed that last time. Anybody recall?
Why or this?
Numbers
why? Why do we get a whole as opposed to a vertical asymptote? I mean, we get a whole and we get a vertical asymptote when the denominator is zero. So why is it that we get a whole sometimes and a vertical asymptote others?
Well, we get a whole because they can, like, we can get a whole because it sort of like it comes like we can cross it out with the numerator.
Okay, so the numerator has a common factor with the denominator,
yeah.
And a factor in the numerator that also becomes zero when you plug in whatever it is, right? Okay, it doesn't happen here. Let's talk about it here. Like, if we had x plus 1 in the numerator and x minus 5 in the denominator, and then this is in the numerator, and in the denominator we have also x minus 5, okay? Well, what do you get out of this function when you plug in 3? Just go ahead and compute it. Tell me what you get when you plug in 3.
4.
4.
Okay. 4. That was pretty fast. Okay, what do you get when you plug in 7?
8.
How are you doing this so quickly? These two, yeah, they like really, it's like they don't matter. It's like when two people go to the polls and one votes Democrat and one votes Republican, they just cancel each other out. Like, it's like nothing happened. It's like, yeah, they went and they voted and each candidate got one more vote, but they each got one more vote. Like, it just doesn't cancel, or it doesn't count, right? So these don't count. Almost for all values of x, it doesn't count. Except for when does it matter? When you plug in 5. But what happens when you plug in, 4, let's make it easier on itself so it's positive, just to the right of 5, we plug in 5.0001, here we, well, we're doing that here too, 5.0001, and here we're putting in 5.0001, well, here we get 6.0001. It's really close to 6. It's kind of not very spectacular. But what's happening when we subtract 5 here?
Just
get 0.0001. Here you get 0.0001. And particularly in the denominator, if we did have like something that's close to 6 divided by 0.0001, now what kind of a number are we going to get? A very large number. Now we're going to essentially multiply by 10s, 100,000, 10,000, by 100,000, or 10,000, by 10,000. We're going to multiply by 10,000, essentially, right? We're going to multiply this number by 10,000. Except, we don't do that, because here's this guy, right? We've got 0.0001 divided by 0.0001. That just cancels each other out exactly. We get 1, right? And the only time that it ever matters, the only time that this function doesn't do exactly this is at 5. Right? So this function looks just like this function, except for when we get to 5. And at 5, then we'll find that whole. Right? Otherwise it looks like the line y equals x plus 1, plotting along just fine, everybody's happy until we get to 5, and then we just skip over it because the function does not output anything. All of the values, these guys just cancel each other out. But we get a vertical asymptote when, we're looking at a function like x plus 2 up here, we factor the denominator and we wind up getting x minus 1. We'll go ahead and put x plus 2 there. We're going to have a hole at negative 2, right? What's going to happen when we get close to 1? We don't cancel anything out, right? When you get close to 1, if we put in 1.0001 here, and 1.0001 and 1.0001, okay? Well, this is going to be 3.0001. This is also going to be 3.0001. They're going to be exactly the same. They're going to cancel each other out. Every time we plug something in for x, they cancel each other out. So what do we have in the numerator now? 1 over 0.0001. So we are now, we are dividing by 0.0001. We are taking 1 and we are multiplying it by 10,000. And if we have more zeros than a 1, we're multiplying it by just that much bigger of a number, really. Okay. So when we don't have like a guy up here to control this guy, getting out of control, he's going crazy, keep him in check. There's nobody to keep this in check. We got this tiny number in the denominator. We're going to divide by it. We're going to get this huge number. That's why our function shoots off to infinity or negative infinity, depending on if it's a positive or a negative number. So that's why that happens. So if I'm looking for a vertical asymptote, I'm looking for 0 in the denominator in a very specific way. In what way am I looking for a 0 in the denominator?
To find an asymptote.
Looking for an asymptote. So asymptotes and holes both happen when the denominator is 0. What's different about a vertical asymptote when the denominator is 0?
The closer you get to 0, the bigger the y value is.
And how can we tell quickly that that's going to happen at 1, but not at negative 2?
Because the 2 would cancel each other out, but when it's at 1, nothing cancels out, so it'll just keep getting bigger the closer you get to 0.
This 0.0001 we get close to 2, or we get close to negative 2, is getting canceled out. But this one is not getting canceled out. It's going completely unchecked. It's getting to divide the numerator by itself. So if we find a 0 in the denominator, and there's not also a 0 in the numerator, if you think about it, like there's a 0 in the denominator when you put a negative 2 in the denominator, also in the numerator, which is kind of, if you haven't factored it yet, that's like a clue that there is a common factor there. They have the same factor, making them both 0. Is that going to happen here? Are we going to find any common factors here? The only factor in the numerator is x. This doesn't have a factor of x, right? Because 2 doesn't have a factor of x, so we can't factor out x. Let's go ahead and factor this denominator.
Sorry.
And what does it factor as?
Plus 2 minus 1.
We have a 0 at negative 2. We have a 0 at 1. Exactly like this. We have a 0 at negative 2, we have a 0 at 1. And at both of those places, what we're going to see in the graph, we're going to see a hole or a vertical asymptote? Vertical asymptote, because there's nothing to cancel out this factor of basically 0.0001 as we get close to 2, or negative 2. And there's nothing to cancel out this one when we get close to 1. Something to cancel it out. So that thing in the denominator is so small and wreaks havoc. You divide by it, it's huge. That's the issue. So we can just quickly look at that function. Code. We have x divided by the quantity of x squared plus x plus 2. See 1, and you can see how negative 2 is an issue. Let's zoom out here. Like at negative 2, we see this on the left side. Apparently, we're dividing the numerator by this teeny negative number, because right, it goes down toward negative infinity because of a very large negative number. Over on the right, we have values that are bigger than negative 2, so when we add 2 to that, we get this positive number, and we divide by a positive teeny number, and we get positive infinity. The same thing happens over here.
How did he figure out that he needed?
Because it doesn't have a factor in common in the numerator to keep it in check and keep canceling it out. that make sense when I say that? When I say it doesn't have
even check,
cancel it out. Pretty much make it not do anything except at that one point. Both of those factors just wreak havoc on the function in general. Okay. So the next one. So it's from 42. So we want to figure out what does this function do as x gets closer and closer to zero on the left. So these the teeny, teeny, teeny negative number is going to happen. Well, what are we going to get when we put a teeny, 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 teeny negative number in here?
Small, positive number.
Yeah, it's going to be positive, and when you take a decimal multiply by itself, it gets even smaller. So yeah, it's going to be
tiny.
Okay. What about this guy when I put in a teeny, 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 teeny? It's going to be some big thing, right?
It's going to be positive.
Because of this. Yes. This, I should have pointed at this better. Yeah, it's going to be a negative number. 1 divided by negative is going to be a negative. 1 divided by a tiny negative is going to be a big, big negative. And then we have this negative to make it positive. Okay. We're going to have a tiny plus a tiny positive plus big positive. So where is this function going?
Infinity.
Up toward positive infinity. Does that make sense? Thinking through it like that?
Sure.
So there's a car, a police car parked here. The siren is going around and around and around. And let's see, the revolving light on top of the car turns at a rate of 1/2 revolution per second. The rate at which the light being moved along the wall is this thing. Okay. Does everybody understand what this is saying?
Yes.
Somebody put it in different words. What this function will tell us when we plug in a theta. Just going yeah, horizontally across the wall. Okay. It's kind of an interesting thing. You imagine as this thing goes like this. Imagine it's a perfect like laser beam light that is powerful and always gets to the target, right? Like it almost seems like it could never leave the wall. Like the light can never come off of the wall because then. What angle would that happen at?
117. Parallel to the wall.
It would, well, if this light is shining, you know, let's shine way out here, the farther out it gets, the tinier this angle is, right?
That angle.
Yeah, that angle. That angle is really, really small. Like, but the farther out it shines, the smaller and smaller and smaller it gets. When will it ever be so small that the light then gets off of the wall and it's parallel with the wall.
Sure
it is, it's a math class, but it's actually a philosophy class. Think about that for a second. We're gonna ask these questions. Find the rate r, how fast the light is moving across the wall. When theta is pi over 6. How are we ever going to figure that out? Put in pi over 6 for theta. If it works, it works. If we get some kind of an error, that's going to be something else to deal with. So R of pi over 6, right, meaning I'm going to plug pi over 6 in here, is equal to 50 pi times the secant squared of pi over 6 feet per second. What's the secant of pi over 6?
It's 1 over root 3 over 2.
1 over root 3 over 2, so 2 over root 3, right, 2 over root 3 squared.
Sure.
All right. Okay. Here we go. 50 pi times 2 over root 3 squared would be 4 over 3. So we get 200 pi over 3 feet per second. No problem there, that's how fast it's moving. About how fast is that? Like, give me a decimal number. It's gotta be close to 200, right?
Yeah.
A little bit more than 200, because 3.143 almost canceled. What? It's got to be more than
200.
209 feet per second. Pretty fast, right? It's pretty fast. Okay, here we go. And let's erase that. Otherwise, it's all the same thing. At pi over 3. The secant is 1 over the cosine, right? The cosine of pi over 3 is 1 half.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so it's 1 over 1 half. So it's 2 squared. That's 4. That's just 200 pi. That's 3 times faster than it was at pi over 6.
698.
Okay, so it is really cooking along. Now let's see what happens. Now let's see what happens at find the limit of r as theta approaches pi over 2. Why is it approaching pi over 2? Why is that an interesting value?
Because it won't be pointed at 90 degrees.
Yes, it's at 90 degrees, and we're looking at the secant. The secant is the 1 over the cosine. What's the cosine?
0.
0, and now so we got 1 over 0. That can't work, right? And there is no secant. So, you know, we try it, and it's just not going to work. That's nothing. I can't even evaluate it. It's not a thing. It's 1 over 0. Okay. So as the secant gets closer to pi over 2 from the left, meaning smaller than pi over 2, which means it's actually going to come up like this on the even circle, if you think about it that way. As that gets closer to pi over 2, this is getting closer to 0, right? So we could even change it to this. The limit of this function as theta moves towards pi over 2 from the left, this is, it's like we could choose this as x and this gets closer to 0 from the right or from the left. Is it coming from positive values or coming from negative values as it approaches, as this approaches 0?
It's coming.
Let's think about it. Remember the secant is 1 over the cosine, yeah? This is going to be 1 over the cosine. And this value right here is going to get closer and closer to 0. What kind of cosine values are we seeing as we get close to pi over 2? What's that? We've got pi over... We're root 3 over 2, we've got root 2 over 2, we've got 1 half. We've got positive cosine values, right? The secant is 1 over the cosine. So this guy, this x, is getting close to 0 from the right. Yeah, the numbers that are getting close to 0 are positive. So it's the same as if we said this is the limit as x approaches 0 from the right. So what's going to happen to this as x gets close to 0? Well, x is going to get close to 0. What's this going to get close to?
Infinity.
Infinity. 1 over a small number.
No.
Squared. 1 over a small number is a big number. Square a big number, you get a bigger number. Multiply by 50, it's 50 times bigger, and times pi is pi bigger than that. So this thing is infinity. Right? As the angle, there's going with this angle. As this angle gets closer and closer to 90, the speed that the actual spot of light goes is infinity. Doesn't that seem strange? Isn't there a limit on how fast things can go?
Oh.
What is the limit on how fast things can go?
Speed of light.
Speed of light. You can't go faster than the speed of light. But this thing's going to infinity, right? The speed of light is finite. So how can something go faster than the speed of light?
Isn't that the rate that it's hitting the wall?
Right. It's like nothing is actually moving. Right? It's not like this thing is spinning faster than the speed of light. But it's just that a point of light is hitting the wall, and then another point of light is hitting the wall, and another point of light is hitting the wall, and the rate at which they're being like laid out next to each other makes it look like there's this spot that's going faster than. Still a weird thing though. What speed does it finally just break away from the wall? That angle is finally 90 degrees. Seems like it never does. But it does.
Right.
Okay. Okay, that's good. Alright, 3.5. Have we done 1.5 enough? Fill in this table. So what's 10 to the 0?
Negative
2.1. 10 to the 0 is 1, that was my
question. Oh yeah. That's
but when you plug in 1, you get...
Yeah.
What?
Negative 2. It was point something, but it was probably like 0.
Oh, 0.00.
003.
003?
I feel like that's just what I remember.
Oh, that's what you remember.
Oh, it'd be negative.
Okay.
You guys.
Now we plug in 10, right? This means we have our calculators, I would hope. We plug this function in. And we're not doing this by hand every time. Negative 6x divided by the square root of 4x squared plus 5. Too many parentheses. It'll still work, though. So we're gonna put in 1, then we're gonna put in 10, then we're gonna put in 100, 1,000, 10,000. Here we go. 2 million. 2 to 6. So 1, we get -2. It's so close to 2. Does it come out just exactly -2?
I don't know. I got -2.
Okay. -2.981. Oh, this looks better. 2.981. This already is rounding to -3 because 2.999. 2.9 more nines, more nines. To the point that the calculator itself says, even when I go over to the y value to get the more exact number, just says -3. Is that right? Do you get -3 when you put a million in there? No, you don't. So what's up with the calculator?
You got so close that it was
infinite. Yeah, I mean, calculator is not an infinite thing. It's finite, so it can only do so much, and some numbers are too big and too small to work with. So the difference between -3 and what you actually get when you plug in a million is too small for the calculator. Plug all those y values in there, and we say that the limit is as x approaches infinity is what? 3?
Negative.
Approaches negative. If we take a look here, that's kind of like, almost like if you ignore this plus 5 inside the square root, if you took the square root of 4x squared, what'd you get?
2.
2x. It's like -6x over 2x. And as x gets bigger, it's more and more like that, because the only difference between it being that and not being that is this plus 5 inside the square root. And as x becomes bigger and bigger, that plus 5 makes less and less difference. Good? Okay. Same thing with this guy. I'm gonna fill in that table. So what do you think is going to, what number are we gonna get close to as we keep putting bigger and bigger numbers in for x when we get to a million? You know, we clearly got
zeros.
And what makes you say that?
Because there's a bigger exponent on the bottom.
If you count this as an x to the zero power.
Four, no.
What's that? Yeah, sorry, this will get close to zero. But then we'll add 4 to almost 0, so the whole thing will get close to 4.
No. Says here, find the limit as x approaches infinity of h of x if possible. So h of x for a is f of x, this guy right here, over x squared. So for a, what is the limit as x approaches infinity? H of x. Is that?
Infinity.
Why is that?
Because when you plug in f of x, you get 5x cubed.
Right.
The largest degree over x squared.
Yep.
The numbers on the numerator will always be much larger.
Yeah, much, much larger. X times larger. So it's so large that the denominator is tiny by comparison. And what
you still get this very big number, so it goes to infinity. B, the limit as x approaches infinity of f of x over x cubed. Well, f of x, as it was pointed out, is that function up there, 5x cubed minus 3x squared plus 10. So, what will this approach as infinity as x goes to infinity?
5.
It'll be, this is the highest power of x. Its coefficient of 5 is 5, so we're going
to
have essentially 5x cubed over x cubed. Right, plus something that's so tiny that it can hardly be distinguished from what 5x cubed is worth, divided by x cubed. So these essentially cancel out the left with 5. Let's see. What would happen if I said, hey, look, I'm going to prove it to you that we get really close to 5, and I plug in this really big number for x. Am I going to get 5 out? No. So, what if somebody was like, well, you're not a 5 yet, you're not close enough, what could you do? Just put a bigger number in, it's even closer to 5. Is that not close enough, what could you do? A bigger number, right? It gets as close as you want. You want to get within the width of the helium nucleus, we can do that, we can get that close.
Okay.
That's how close we are. Limit as x goes to infinity of f of x over x to the fourth. That's not x to the fourth. This is what's going to happen then. We put in the very
approach zero.
It's going to approach zero. This will be so much bigger than this. This is just at most is 5x cubed plus some insignificant stuff because x is so big. That this will overwhelm this guy here. We'll have a relatively small number divided by a relatively large number, and we'll be getting closer and closer to zero. Not close enough, get rid of a bigger number. Not closer still, get rid of another number, bigger number than that. We'll get as close to zero as we want. Arbitrarily close. That was 15. X goes to negative infinity.
No pi
x squared over x plus 3. The main thing you want to think about here is signs. I mean, if you put a big number in for x, you square it, multiply it by 5, and in the denominator you put this big number in for x, and you add 3, which is going to be much, much bigger than the other. The numerator is going to be much bigger, right? So now what just matters is, are we taking a positive by a negative, negative by negative? What is it going to be, right? It's definitely going to just take off towards some infinity. Question is positive or negative. Well, this guy right here, what's this going to be when I plug a negative number into it?
Positive.
Right? So huge negative. Negative huge number. Positive huge number over negative huge number, but not as huge. That's huge. That's not as huge. So what is this function going to do? Like we already talked about, it's going to go to hugeness. Which hugeness will it go to?
Negative.
Negative hugeness. It goes to negative. What you know about the sine function? As I put in a large number, pick a huge number. Just pick a huge number.
100.
That's, oh my gosh, how did you come up with that? So huge. So we're going to take the sine of 200, right? Because we're going to multiply 100 by 2. 200 radians What's the sine of 200 radians? Or what can you tell me about the sine of 200 radians? Not 200 pi radians.
200 radians.
So it's kind of not on.
Oh, it's not between 1 and negative 1.
It is between 1 and negative
oh.
1. Yeah, I'm sorry if I made it sound like
oh,
you were wrong about that. Yeah, whatever the sine of that angle is, at most it's 1, and at the very least it's negative 1. So this numerator is bouncing between 1 and negative 1, okay? Now the denominator, what's happening with the denominator?
It's
getting to be really big.
Yeah.
Right? What is the biggest this expression could be worth?
What is he trying to solve?
1.
What?
Oh, wait, no,
this,
not that,
yes,
not
1.
That, not that.
The biggest that this could be is 1. And it would be over x, right? The biggest it could be is like the full value of whatever 1 over x is, right? Other than that, like that is the, whatever that is. The smallest 1 over x is, that's the biggest that this could be. So 1 over x will always be bigger than the sine of 2x over x, right? Am I right about that? Well, what is the smallest that it could be? Negative 1 over x. So negative 1 over x is the absolute bottom of this function. Okay? So this guy is always between these two. Does that make sense? Always between these two. It's what's squeezed in between these two functions. The value of these two functions is always closing in on the value of this function. Squeezed in between them. It'll never break above this one, and it'll never break down below this one. Okay. This is what we're doing right now. It's called the squeeze theorem. What's it called? Some people call it the sandwich theorem, but it's not called that. It's called the squeeze theorem. And it's because the value of this function is squeezed between these two functions. If you look at the graphs, graph of 1 over x at least toward positive infinity is going to look like this. Of negative 1 over x is going to look like this. And the sine of 2x over x is going to be, let me think about this, this. Something like this. Right? And it's going to go up and down and up and down and up and down between 1 over x and negative 1 over x. What is 1 over x going to get close to as x goes to infinity?
0.
It's going to come down towards 0. And what is negative 1 over x going to get close to as x goes to infinity?
0
from down here. And where is sine of 2x over x? Squeezed between them. So sine of 2x over x must
approach 0.
Also go to 0. So this is 0. The best that it can do is to bounce all the way up to 1 over x or all the way down to negative 1 over x. That's the best that it can do. And anything else, it's just in between those two. Tight spot between 1 over x and negative 1 over x. Small case. Any other question? No? Nice. Sorry, it's a little hot in here.
It's good.
Nice. Let's go ahead and pass in the homework then. Yeah, all that even though all that almost blank sheet paper, well, it should not be blank, it should have been. Okay. So we're going to approach 3 from the right. The funny thing about like actual functions that aren't piecewise functions or just pictures of functions as graphs. Function, where there is no function to the left of 0. So a lot of times what we can do is just, what is the limit? If the limit exists, then of course the limit from the right is the same as the limit. So this, you know, is not good, because when we plug in 3, what do we get in the denominator, I hope? 0, this is bad. So we need to factor it out. But there's an x minus 3 down there.
Minus.
don't care what happens at 6, right? We're not asking that. We're asking what happens when we approach 3. Right. So we're going to, from the right, we're going to approach numbers that are bigger than 3.
Yes.
So we're going to minus 3, so we're going to get a positive, right? Positive, small positive. And what about here? Doesn't matter, does it?
And.
Whether this is negative, well, if this is negative, this is negative. If this is positive, this is positive. They're identical to each other, they're just going to cancel each other out anyway. What happens when we take this 1 and divide it by a small positive number? Quite big. Quite big and positive. Stop me if I ever move on too quickly. I will back to this one. We got, I bet it's x minus 4 times x. Now we're approaching 4 from the left, which means we're putting in numbers that are less than 4, which means if we're supposed to get a tiny negative number, right? Mm-hmm. So we'll put in like 3.999, subtract 4, and we'll get a small, negative small number. What kind of number are we going to get here when we put in something that's really close to 4 on the left? That's a positive number because we're going to take something that's close to 4 and add 3 to it. So we're going to have, say, close to 7, but less than 7. Then we put something that's to the left of 4 in for this x, and we get something that's close to 9. What happens when you multiply a negative small number by 7? Still negative. 7 times bigger, but what's 7 times bigger than a really small number? Still slightly less small, but it's still really, really small. So we get down here a negative small number. We got a positive 9-ish here. What happens when we take the positive 9-ish and divide it by a negative small number?
Negative large.
Yeah, we divide a number by a tiny number. If you get a big number, it's negative. So it's negative. Gets very large, what's this function going to get close to?
0.
That denominator is so big, it divides this thing that is relatively so small, so that we get close to 0. Here, it's not so unbalanced, right? So as we put larger and larger and larger numbers in, we're going to get closer and closer and closer to what on our y value? As we, because these both have the same power, if we put in 809 billion trillion million, okay, and we square it, and we multiply it by 2, and we put the same thing in here, and we square it, you know, we get the exact same thing when we square it. And this one's basically 5, this one's 2, right? They're kind of keeping up at the same rate. They're getting bigger and bigger, like crazy bigger, but at the same rate. This one is a factor of 5 to this factor. This stuff doesn't really matter. You add 9 to 200 million billion trillion, like it's plus 9. 2 million billion trillion plus 9, it's not a big difference. And neither is this. This does not make much of a difference. So we've got a ratio of 2 to 5. Then we're getting closer to it. Okay? And we should check. We're approaching negative infinity. So should it be negative or is it going to be positive?
It's
going to
be positive.
Because these are going to be positive, right? And in any case, even if they were both, well, I won't say that. But yeah, the squaring something makes it positive always, so this will approach positive 2/5. Last one. this one's, the x is going to negative infinity. We're putting these huge negative numbers in here, so now we need to ask ourselves what's going to happen. Which is bigger, the numerator or denominator? Numerator is going to be bigger. It's got an x cubed. That x cubed is much bigger than x squared. So now the question is, if it's big, right, infinity, which infinity is it go to? Why do you say that?
Because it's negative on top, positive on bottom.
Right, we're going to take a negative cubed, that's negative. Negative times negative times negative, it's negative. Square negative, you get a positive number. And so we have a negative versus a positive. A negative huge number versus a positive relatively small number, we're going to get negative huge number. Finding the x value, yes, you found where the hole is.
Where the